What are you doing while you're waiting? What are you doing while you're waiting? Because the truth is that there is a season between when God speaks and when you see. There's a season that occurs between the time God gives you a word, or the time you have a vision, or the time something's been prophesied over your life, and until you see all those things come to pass. There's a season in between, and I know that many of us have heard sermons about God coming, and you're going to live your best life now, and this is your season. It's a song. This is your season, right? Ain't that Israel? It's a new season. It's a new day, right? But you get so excited about when someone tells you it's your time. Yo, you're going to be, God is so good, and I see some stuff on your life, and it is about to just blow your mind. You won't believe what God wants to do in your life. Or this one, the glory that's on you. Right? And y'all heard all that stuff? Yeah. And then you get that, and you're so excited, and then like 3 months later, you're like, hold on, did we get a word about it being my time? This don't feel like my time. Matter of fact, it's got hard, it's got difficult, it's got frustrating, it's got aggravating. I'm dealing with people, and these people that got something to say every time. They tell me not to talk too much, so I don't talk too much. Now they saying, what's wrong? When I don't say nothing, they're like, speak up. It's always something that usually comes after you get this word about it's your time. So let me be transparent with you. I struggle with the idea of more. More is my drug. Can I be transparent with y'all? I'm gonna give y'all my devotion. More is my drug. It's hard for me to be satisfied. I hope I'm not just talking to myself, but it's like. You want this, and then when you got this, you need more of this. If you get that, that is great. Now you want more of that. And I have this like problem with always working hard to achieve the next thing. Yo, I wrote a book. I graduated from college. I started a ministry, and I never celebrate. Matter of fact, these two had to take me out and say, yo, chill out and just celebrate what you're doing, because I always want more. I'm on to the next thing, because I want more of whatever this is. And God said, I need you to study this thing called waiting. I need you to study this thing called, I'm telling you, in two weeks, I got a message that's going to blow your mind. While I was studying for this, I was looking at the life of David. I'm not going to preach David yet, because I'm not finished crafting the sermon. In 2 weeks, we're going to be at our Northeast campus. That's the last Saturday in June. Trust me, you don't want to miss this. But as I was studying the life of David, I ain't got no structure. I got a little bit, but I'm just talking. As I was studying the life of David, so y'all remember when he got anointed as king? Remember that? Bam! She said, get your hands on. She had a fist bump. Y'all can't see what she did. Y'all remember when David got anointed as king? Well, right after that, he actually wrote the Psalms, Though I Lie Here in Green Pastures. Because he's the next king, but yet he's still in the field. He's been told, you are the next king. It's yours. This is your kingdom. Yet he's playing a harp in the field, fighting lions, tigers, and bears. this period of waiting. And then it becomes extra hard because we live in a society today that everything is rapid speed. It's like, yo, I remember when the iPhone 3G came out, and it was like, yo, that's so dope. Now if your phone is on a 3G speed, it's like, if you don't hurry up. They've simplified even interview process. Everything is electronic now so that you can get it the same day. This entire world is speeding itself up. They're making cars faster. They're trying to simplify your fast food experience level. Now they've got open tables so you don't have to wait as long. It's like, and this whole world is placing itself in a position where you no longer have to wait, yet you got a God that does not change. And sometimes he's going to say, wait. And you look at Abraham. Abraham was pretty cool. Abraham gets this promise. He says, hey, I got a few verses. Y'all can help me out? I got a bunch of verses. Like I said, this is my devotion time. I got a bunch of verses. I need someone to go over there to Hebrews 6, 14 and 15. Someone read it. I don't care. Let me read it. Someone let me. You got it? Look at this. When God had made his promise to Abraham, since there was no one greater for him to swear by, he swore to himself saying, I will surely bless you and give you many descendants. That's the hooray. And so get this, look at verse 15. And so after waiting patiently, Abraham received what he was promised. After waiting patiently, that right there lets us know that there's a wait that's going to happen once the promise is given. And it's got to be a patiently wait. We got to patiently wait for this thing. You can't be frustrated and want your promise at the same time. Here's what I discovered. And I'm telling you, look, this right here is so tweetable. When God gave me this, I was like, it's good. You ever do that? It's good. He said, let me write it. I want to read it verbatim because I don't want to mess it up. Look. The work that God is doing in you while you wait is just as important as the thing you're waiting on. The work that God is doing in you while you wait is just as important as the thing you're waiting on. Oftentimes, when God gives you a promise, when God gives you a declaration, when he says he gives you a word, see, we get so caught up on the word that he's given us and not the process we have to go through to get to where he told us to go. And a lot of times, what God is trying to do is he's telling you, come on, man, where you're going to prepare you for what you're getting ready to go through. So that when you go through whatever the next season is, you can have an image of what God is trying to produce while you waiting. The waiting patiently, the reason why patiently is there is because there's going to be a level of problems, a level of confrontation, a level of seasons where you're going to have to endure, and you got to wait patiently. And so the reason why you can now wait patiently is because he's giving you an image and a word of where he's trying to take you. And so when you know where he's trying to take you, you don't mind about waiting, because this is like when you go to Ruth Chris. Ruth Chris has the slowest service I've ever seen in my life, but nobody complains because they know what they're about to eat. No one complains. We took the whole staff to Ruth Chris a couple months. We didn't eat for an hour, but nobody complained because of the food that was coming. What am I saying? Don't complain in the season that you're in, because you know what's coming. And you'll wait patiently because you're like, hey, look, I know it might not seem like God is going to bring this promise through, but he already gave his word, and his word cannot return void. So I might not see it yet. It might be uncomfortable. It might be frustrating. It might be some stuff that really makes me want to just slap somebody's mama. But I'll tell you this much, I can wait patiently. Hey, I'm talking for my devotion. I'm preaching to myself. Somebody. Come on. God told me this. He said, there's only three answers to prayer. Yes, no, and wait. And wait. And so I was, can I give y'all some like preaching revelation that I got? I mean, some serious preaching. Jen, go over there to John chapter 11. I think it's like verse 4. I got some serious preaching revelation. I'm talking about one of those things. Look, I was reading this word, and when I was reading it, it was one of those like this. Whoa! Didn't see that before. Let me tell you something. When you in your alone time with God, I dare you to pray this prayer. I've been praying it recently. You know, I got some sermons. This I'm telling you. Say, God, show me something I've never seen before. It's that simple. Show me something I've never seen before. Because I read this thing for hours. And so sometimes I'm just like, I know what's coming next. And I'm being honest with you. This is like me being transparent. It's sometimes where I sit down and read this Bible, and I'm just like, okay, I know this. And I think that's where many people get frustrated at, is because you don't know how to read the word to make it come alive. And so you like, I already know that Jesus got up on the third day. I only want to read this chapter. Let me go to the next chapter. But the Bible is living. Yeah. It's living. And so if you can pray, show me something new. Tell me, just try that this week. So I prayed that, and I was reading in John chapter 11, and I'm studying his weight and stuff. And he showed me something so new. Can I try it out with y'all to see if y'all get it just as excited as I did? Read that, Jen. John. Yeah, make sure that's the right one. Yeah. Okay, so here's where we at. Look, Lazarus just died, right? I just preached this like a couple weeks ago if y'all was there. And so I, for whatever reason, God brought me back to it. I'm like, I already read this. All right, show me something new. So Lazarus just died, right? And the people are coming to tell Jesus about it. Now, that's the backdrop. Now read this, watch this.
Lazarus, when Jesus heard about it, he said, Lazarus' sickness will not end in death. No, it happened for the glory of God, so that the Son of God will receive glory from this.
Okay, stop right there. I don't think that's the right one. Let me show. I don't know where I'm at, Jen. Yeah, that's it. Keep saying that.
So although Jesus loved Martha, Mary, and Lazarus, he stayed where he was for the next
2 years. That's it. Listen. No. Don't. That was the revelation right there. Look, Lazarus just died, and he said, "Because I love you, I'm gonna stay." Well, Lazarus is sick. I'm sorry. Lazarus is sick. And he says, because I'm going to love you, I'm going to stay. Read that in the NIV. Is that the NIV version? Read the NIV version. Because that's the one where I was like, yo, this is crazy. I got to connect this. That's his homeboy. Martha, Mary, and Lazarus are Ace, Boone, and Coon. And so when your Ace, Boone, Coon gets sick, you're supposed to go over there and see them. You're supposed to say, okay, I'm coming right away, because they know he has the power to what? Heal him. He has the power to heal. Read, now read this in the NIV.
It says, when he heard this, Jesus said, this sickness will not end in death. No, it is for God's glory, so that God's Son may be glorified. Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister Lazarus.
So that's it. Now Jesus loved Mary and Martha and Lazarus. So he stayed. He loved them, so he said, you're going to have to wait on me. I'm not going to come when you want me to. You're going to have to wait because I love you. I'm not going to come when you want. They did not come to Jesus so that he could just stay there. They came to Jesus so they could come back with him, with them. And he responds, because I love you, I'm going to make you wait. I know you want me to come right now, but I'm going to make you wait. But notice what he said before. He ain't dead. He gave them a promise inside of that. The boy just rested. There was something that Jesus needed to happen in Mary and Martha and Lazarus' life. There was something that had to happen in their life that God could get glory out of it. But if he came when they wanted him to come, then it would have been void. It would not have happened. It would not have been productive. It wouldn't have been fruitful. But because he loved them, even though he wanted them to come, he said, no, I gotta wait. You're gonna have to wait. You are going to have to wait because I love you. And I don't think sometimes we ever equate love and waiting in the same sentence when it comes to a matter like this. My boy is on his deathbed, but I ain't going there because I love you. God, I need this job right now. I can't give you that right now because I love you. God, please bring me a man. Can't give you that right now. Lord knows I can't give you that right now. You ain't ready. He ain't ready for you. You ain't ready for me. Because I love you. He calls us to win because there's love there. I said, God, what do you mean? Can I be honest with you? Yo, I'm so baby stepping this engaged thing. I don't need your faith for what I'm just talking to myself, man. But engage is gonna be huge. But right now I'm just waiting. I'm just waiting. But there's a level of faithfulness that has to occur while you wait. Yo, our parents is throwing one of the bombest cookouts right now. I can't wait to leave here and go get that food. But we gotta wait. Because there's a level of faithfulness that God is trying to see when you're waiting. Can you endure while you're waiting? And so I want to give you four things to do while you wait. Is that okay? Four things to do while you wait, and we're going to be done. I got 20 minutes. Because y'all know the new time, we're going to be done before 7 o'clock all summer. Ain't that exciting? That came right in time. Here's the first thing that happens while you're waiting. Develop your gift. Develop your gift. A lot of times, God gives you a word of where he wants to take you. Go over there to Matthew 25. You don't even gotta go over there. Y'all know Matthew 25, the parable of the talents? Y'all know that? Somebody got 5 talents, one got 2, another got 1. And the one that got 1 took his talent and he hid it in the ground. That's the worst thing you can do in your waiting season. You see, because, yeah, they understand they had to wait on the master's what? Return. And when the master came back after the people who had the money distributed to them, the talents distributed to them, he wanted to see a return on the investment that he had given them. Yeah? And so the one that had 5 and the one that had 2, they developed their gift. But the one who had 1 hid it in the ground. And he was so infuriated with them because he said, how the heck? I know you was waiting for me to come back, but why would you not develop this thing? when you're in your waiting season for over the promise that God has given you, over the word that God has given you, this is not your time to take your talent and to take your gift and to hide it in the ground. This is the time that you gotta develop the thing that God has given you. Man, I'm telling you, I practice preaching 5-6 hours a day. This thing started in my dorm room and at Salisbury University when we was having a Bible study, and he gave me a vision that this thing was gonna go all the way around the world, and I was in my room, my dorm room, by myself, opening up my word, giving oratory. I was developing the gift that God was giving me. She hears me now. My mom and dad, they hear me now. I'm always developing the gift that God has given me, because when he calls on you, will you be ready? Or when you return, will he say, why did you hide this thing in the ground? I gave you the word of what I was going to do for your life. I told you what you had promised. I told you where I wanted you to go. Why are you still sitting on your butt? Why you not in the place, in the position where you're taking the tools and the resources and the gifts that God has deposited inside of you, and you're letting them go to waste when you should be developing them, so that when the time comes, can I give you a sneak peek of the fourth Saturday? Give you a sneak peek. Look, David was in the field playing the harp. He was playing the harp. He just got told that he was going to be king. So then the next king says, find me a harp player. I heard David is the baddest harp player in the land. He was developing the gift that God had given him for a promise that he had delivered to him. There's some gifts in your life that you gotta develop, because your gifts will make room for you. And sometimes it's not the thing that you thought it was gonna be that's gonna bring you before the king. It's gonna be the gift that he deposited into you. And if you don't take the time to develop it, you'll never experience what God wants for you. You gotta develop the gift. Why you wait? Y'all having fun? Y'all ready for the second one? You gotta build your faith. While you're waiting, you gotta build your faith. You ready for this? I'm excited. Go over to Galatians 6:4-5. I want someone else to go to Hebrews 10:36. Can I give you this teaching tip? This next point, I'm developing a whole sermon. I told you I'm going to insert out of my devotion. So this next point, I'm developing a whole sermon around this one point. You ready? So you got to build your faith. And while you're doing that, you got to remember this, that you can't get caught up in comparing your chapter to someone else's calling. Listen to what I just said. You can't get caught up in comparing your chapter in life right now to someone else's calling. See, because I told you, man, I'm obsessed with more. This is a chapter of my life. If I go to another ministry and start looking at what they got, that's their call. And so when we get mixed up is that we start saying, man, I wish I was there. But we have overlooked the chapter that God has called us to be in right now. You can say, man, I love how that everyone's getting engaged and everyone's getting married. And you can start comparing your chapter in life right now when God has you in a season of waiting. And you can get to the point where you start to creep over into coveting what someone else has. Because coveting is the ability to admire while at the same time want to acquire what you just admired. When you want to acquire the things that you admire, you just stepped into coveting. The ability to just admire something and say, hey, that's cool, that's great, I see what you're doing, but look, that ain't my time. This is the chapter that I'm in, and I'm okay with this because God is developing some gifts inside of me, and I'm waiting for patiently because I know that every word of God cannot come back void. He already spoke it. He already said it. I believe it. This is my time to water the seed. This is my time to really take the time to develop this stuff that God has inside of you. Watch this. Go over to Galatians 6:4-5. That's I think that's what I said, right? Read that, Jen. That's hot. Yeah, that's good. Stop right there. What version is that? The Message? Give me the Message version. Watch this. Watch this. Y'all still rocking with me? This good? Like I said, this ain't a sermon. It's just, you know, just my notes. It's how I talk to myself. Of who you are, right there. Make a careful exploration of who you are. Not who someone else is. Make a careful exploration of who you are. Keep reading, Jen.
And the works you have been given.
Stop right there. Look, you got to carefully explore who you are in the work that you've been given, or the gifts that you've been given, or the talents that you've been given. Keep going. Not right there. And then sink yourself into that. Yo, when you sink yourself into what God has for you, you ain't care about what nobody else doing and what's going on over there. That's your call. That's cool. I ain't even going to compare myself. I got enough stuff to develop inside of me. I got to sink myself into what God has for me to do and what He's called me to be. I ain't got time to be focusing on what everybody else has got going on. God has given me enough of my own plate. Still working on these collard greens. I'm thinking about this food, boy. Come on. Come on, Jen. Keep reading. Keep reading. Uh-oh.
Uh-oh.
Don't compare yourself
with others. Stop right there. Hold on. After I make a careful exploration of what God has called me to do, and I see the work that He has for me, He said, don't get impressed with yourself. You ain't that cute. That's what He said. You ain't that cute. You ain't that cute. And then He said, then don't compare yourself to others. Because they ain't that cute. He didn't say that. I said that. Go ahead. Stop right there. You gotta take time to do the best that you can with your own life. See, when you get caught up in yourself, that ain't arrogant, that ain't cocky. No, God has given me some stuff that I gotta focus on for myself. So I ain't got time to get caught up in your stuff, because look, when you get caught up in doing the careful exploration of yourself, the time will seemingly go by faster. When you honest with yourself, okay, I got to work on this and I got to work on that. Oh, Lord, I got to work on this. And you begin to develop those things that God has brought attention to in your life. I'm telling you, that's how you work up patience. The other one was Hebrews 10, wasn't it? Hebrews 10 what? Who got it? I don't remember what it was. Hebrews 10:36, I think. Yeah. Anybody got it? Read out loud. Be loud so them online campus can y'all. Hey, online campus, I love y'all so much. I really do. Yeah. It can be message NIV. I don't care. Anyone.
Yeah. Patient endurance is what you need.
Stop right there. Patient endurance is what you need now. Keep reading.
So that you will continue to do God's will, then you will receive all that He has.
Hold on, because that then is important. That's a preposition that is very important, because you can't have what's after the then until you have done what's before the then. What do you mean? You after you clean your room, then you can go outside. Right? You can't go outside until what? You clean your room. And so after this then, read after the then. This is good teaching, right? Read after the then.
Then you will receive all that He has promised.
Stop right there. How many of us want to receive all that He has promised? And I love that word, all. Come on, then and all, those are very important words in Scripture, because what the all means is that every single word that's been spoken over you, every single promise that God has given you, everything that God has declared over your life, you've got access to. If you do what's before what? The then. So read before the then. Come on, patient endurance is what you need right now. Don't just endure, endure patiently. Many of us get so anxious. That's why Apostle Paul said, be anxious for nothing. There's some stuff that I'm trying to get. I need you to understand, when you're patient, that's when God responds. He responds to you being patient. Oh, a lot of us will endure, but we're going to endure and complain at the same time. And complaining endurance will disqualify you from the promise that God wants to give you. But the moment you can endure and be patient at the same time, now you're starting to get God's attention. Patient endurance is what you need now. It's going to come. There's no word that can come back void. It's going to come. Stay patient. Stay patient. Patient endurance is what you need now. Keep going. Stop right there. So is important. Patient endurance is what you need now. So the so is connected to the patient's endurance. That's good teaching, right? So what?
That you will continue to do God's will.
So that you will continue to do God's will. Now, if you went back over to the Galatians, he said, look, dude, here's the will. Look at yourself. Make a careful exploration of yourself. Sink yourself into that. Don't compare yourself to other people. Focus on me. This is when you'll find the will for your life, when you're more concerned about what you need to do to develop the gifts that God has given you. Once you do that, patiently endure this thing, then you'll receive all that God has promised you. Hey man, I heard that. Man, you're going to receive all that God has promised you this year. Woo! That's some good stuff, man. My devotion time is crazy. Crazy on fleek. Yeah. Now watch this. Here go my third. Y'all want the third one? Here's the third one. While you're waiting, you're trusting God deepens. While you're waiting, your trust in God deepens. I need a couple verses on this to help make this come out, okay? So I need James 5, 7 and 8. Anybody, give me that. James 5, 7 and 8. I need Psalms 37 and 34. I need Psalms 27 and 14, and the last one is Lamentations 3:23. I'm telling you, bro, when I connect all this, here we go. James 5, 7 and 8. Psalms 37 and 34. Psalms 27 and 14, and Lamentations 3:23. Who got James? Anybody got James? You got it, James? Read it.
Dear brothers and sisters, be patient as you wait for the Lord's return.
Hold on. Be patient. I just wanted to pause so y'all could work on being patient. Go ahead.
Consider the farmers who patiently wait for the rains in the fall and in the spring. They eagerly look for the bountiful harvest to ripen.
Come on.
You too must be patient. Take courage for the coming of the Lord is near.
Hey. Look. They said, consider them farmers who put their seed in the ground and then wait patiently for it. What am I trying to say? Once you plant the seed, you can't dig it back up to check on if it's grown. You just gotta trust that it's germinating. See, when you put the seed in the ground, you can't start checking and trying to figure out, look, there's some seeds that you all have placed in this ground, baby. You placed some seeds in this ground. You can't start picking up and checking. You just gotta trust God that the seeds that you have deposited into this world, it's gotta come back. See, the trust happens because you saying, God, I'm trusting you said this word. I've now placed seed attached to this word. I ain't gotta dig it up. I ain't gotta figure out what's going on. I just trust you. The same way the farmers know that once they put that seed in the ground and the rain comes, it's gonna come up. The harvest has got to come. The harvest has got to come in your life. You can't spend your time trying to dig it up and worry and figure out if it's going to happen. You place the seed there, it's going to have a harvest. And you'll patiently wait until that harvest comes. Consider the farmers. And if that works for the farmers, why wouldn't it work for the kingdom of God? Getting excited. I'm trying to be chill. No. But when you, look, baby, we got so much seed in this ground. I got so much seed. Yo, I've purposed my life to be a sower. And you can't get, look, I know many of you all are sowing. You sowing seeds. It don't even got to be money. You sowing your time. You sowing your love. You sowing your appreciation. You sowing your gratification and thankfulness. You sowing forgiveness. You got to know that when you sow that stuff in the ground, it's got to come back full. It can't, come on, it's got to come back. Don't ever second guess the seed that you sow. Don't you ever second guess it. You sowed it and you trust and believe God that it's got to come back. Come down, boy. Psalms 37:34. You got it. You got it. Let's read it.
Wait patiently for God. Don't leave the path.
Ho. Wait patiently for God. Don't leave the path. Because so many of us, we get on the path once God gives the word. Once God gives the word, we get on the path that lines up with the word that he's given us. Hey, guess what? I'm bringing a husband to you. And so we'll stop dealing with these certain boys, right? But the moment that the time has expired and when we thought our husband will be here, we get off the path that was headed that way and we start answering those dumb text messages and phone calls because the waiting season we got impatient during and we got right back on something that we had no business being. Look, wait patiently and don't leave the path. There's a path that God has for you, and it's attached to waiting patiently. And if you wait patiently and don't leave the path, keep reading. That's why you can't compare to other people, because you can get so caught up in comparing, because the wicked gonna have some stuff. The wicked gonna have some stuff. The world has stuff because your eyes are attracted to what they got. And if you get to the point where you start comparing your path and comparing your call to someone else's chapter and calling in life, you end up on the same path as them and lose your stuff as they losing their stuff because you ain't stay where God told you to stay because you got impatient. And this whole thing is set up so that when everyone else is losing their stuff, you still got your stuff, and now they want to figure out how you did it. How you keep your stuff. You kept your stuff because you never stopped waiting on the Lord. I'm telling you, man. I'm so excited about what God is going to do this year. Wait patiently. Just wait on it. What's the next one? Psalms what? Yeah. Read that. Stop right there. I'm sure now. I'm sure now. Some of you all got to have that confession. I'm sure now that I'm going to see God's goodness. Despite what it looks like right now, everything is going helter-skelter, everything is going crazy. It's not the way that I thought it was going to go. I had this idea that God was going to come with me, but he told me to wait. He said, no, I can't have you come right now because I love you, but I'm sure now. I'm sure now. Keep reading. Stay with God. Don't leave this path. Don't leave this path. Don't quit. Stay now. Go to Lamentations. I got to hurry up. Who got Lamentations? You got it? Read loud. Greatest is faithfulness. God is faithful. Keep reading. Was that it? Yeah. Just that. That's it. Just 23. That was it. Yeah. Great is God's faithfulness. Trust God. I got my one more point. Y'all ready for the last one? God, while you're waiting, you got to understand that God is setting the stage to get the glory. Your God is setting, listen to me out there, while you're waiting, I don't know what it is that you're waiting for. I don't know what it is that God has promised you and it has not come to pass yet. But while you're waiting, God is setting the stage to get the glory. He wants the glory in your life. He doesn't want you to quit and give in and cower, because that's what this world does. The moment that it gets hard, they take their hands off the plow. God wants you to be patient, to endure the test, to stay on the path, because it's all set up for God to get the glory in your life. When your stuff comes to pass, when the promise comes to pass in your life, people are going to ask, how in the world did this happen? And you'll be able to say, because I never wavered in my faith. I trusted God. I developed my gift. I got to a place where I knew that surely God is for me. And because he's for me, I will not quit. I will not cower. I will not give in. God will get the glory in the midst of this. God is for you. Now let's go back over there to John. John chapter 11, verse 40. John chapter 11, verse 40. Anyone got it? Who got it? I gotta hurry up. You got it? Yeah, read that. Let me read it. Appreciate it, sir. Jesus responded. So look. Lazarus is dead, right? Remember we read in verse 4. He said, yeah, boy ain't sick. That boy ain't dead. He just resting. He just resting. This is so that God would get the glory. So now at this point, Lazarus is dead. And so verse 40, Jesus responded, didn't I tell you that you would see God's glory? Get this. If you believe. If, that's an important word. You don't see God's glory if you don't believe. But if I believe, I'll see God's glory. So they rolled the stone aside. Here you go. Then Jesus looked up to heaven and said, while you're patiently waiting, this is how you pray. Father, thank you for hearing me when I pray. I want this in the NIV. Where's this at in the NIV? Let me get it. I got it. Look at this. Watch this. Father, I thank you that you have heard me. Look at this. I know you always hear me. Come on. Father, I thank you that you heard me. I know you always hear me. Watch this. Look what he said. Look. But I said this for the benefit of the people standing here. Now, time out. Something's happened here. Regis, something's happened. Lazarus is dead. Jesus waited because he loved him. He said, I'm doing this for God's glory. Lazarus died, and somewhere between Lazarus dying and Jesus showing up, people have gathered. You gotta know that when God gives you a promise and it looks as if the promise that he gave you has not come to pass, there are going to be some people that's going to gather in your life, because you spoke a word and you said that God has told me this. But when it looks like the this has not shown up yet, now people are going to gather because they're trying to see what the heck is this thing you're talking about, because if God said he's going to do it, why he ain't doing it yet? Somehow people have gathered. I'm sure there's some people that have gathered in your life because you have been waiting patiently for God to do something, and you probably went out on a limb and spoke some stuff, and people starting to try to, they're like, oh, where the stuff at? You said it was going to happen. Where the stuff at? I thought you said this was your year. Year almost over. Where your stuff at? There's some people that will gather, but the reason why, come on, I figured this out. The reason why sometimes God don't come when you want him is because there's not enough people gathered yet in your life. Oh, come on, come on. There's not enough people in your life gathered yet. It's just you and him. He knows that you trust God, but you connect to some people that don't trust God. You connect to some people who don't believe that God's going to do what he's told you to do. So he'll wait just long enough for the people to gather, for the situation to look like it's not yet going to come to pass. That's when he shows up. He shows up when the people have gathered and doubt has been created, but yet you still trust God. He ain't gonna give it to you when it's just you and him in the room. He knows you believe. This life is much bigger than you. It's about people who don't believe. And these people have gathered. Watch this. Father, I know that you hear me. Matter of fact, you always hear me. What if we started praying like that? Father, I know you hear me. There's some stuff that I got to bring to your attention. Matter of fact, I know. Josh, I know he hears me. He hears every single word I pray. He hears every single moan and groan that I've grimaced. And when everything was painful and I was in this room by myself crying my tears out at night because I had to hold it together, but I really wanted to break down and cry, he heard it. You always hear me. He always hears you. Even when you don't have nothing to say, but you speak in your heavenly language, he always hears you. He knows the ache. He knows the groan. He knows the moaning. He knows every single pout and sigh and cry and tear. He knows it. He said, you always hear me. Not just when I'm praying, even when I'm not praying, you hear me while I'm waiting patiently. But I said this for the people standing here, that they may believe you sent me. When he had said this, Jesus called in a loud voice. Look at this. Lazarus, come out. Exclamation point. He yelled that thing. Come out. The dead man came out. His hands and feet wrapped in with strips of linen and a cloth around his face. Jesus said, take off them grave clothes and let them go. Let me tell y'all something. Them promises that God is giving you that you haven't seen yet, tell that thing to come out. Come out and take them grave clothes off. You ain't dead. The promise is not over. Look, every single word that God is giving you, it will come to pass. Don't you dare give up. Don't you dare quit. Don't you dare give in. If the promise has went forth, it's going to come to pass. Come on, I said it's going to come to pass. You got to know that there's no grave that can hold a promise of God. And he's called you to be free. His promises.